Colin MacDonald from the Trews in the Rock Zoom Room. Sir,
how are you?
A little while since you sat in this corner right here, although you can't tell because I've got the green screen behind me. So
it's a good green screen. It's on brand, man.
You like it, eh?
Yeah, it's good to keep the. I should have a Trews one in the background. You know, just remind people the whole time. It's good.
That would be all right, but yeah. At least we get to see a comfortable little space in your house.
I'll put one of my vinyls behind me just while I'm talking, so people remember.
Okay, beautiful. So, back to the grind, thankfully.
Yeah, gratefully back.
Yeah,
to the grind.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, like, you know, what can I say that hasn't already been said about the last couple of years?
I know.
Thankful that we got a record out of it, and certainly grateful that we get to go back out and play music for people.
And the record recorded under challenges that you were able to leverage using modern technology and create in ways that you never imagined back in 2002 when you were living out of a suitcase and sleeping on your uncle's couch in Oshawa.
Yeah, I mean, truer words have not been spoken. You're absolutely right. And we kind of got, like everybody else in our business, we got, thrust into the social media age. We were always kind of doing it begrudgingly because we were old school and we thought, I don't want to be on Twitter and Instagram and all that nonsense. But it became a lifeline in the pandemic. It was our only way to stay connected with our fans or anybody interested in what we were doing. And then it also became the only way we could get any work done, because in quarantine, we would do writing sessions over Zoom. And then anytime there was a little loosening in the restrictions, we'd get together to jam. And then if there was another loosening, we'd get together in a studio and record. So the technology in its own weird way kind of saved us, you know?
Mm-hmm. And, adaptation is so important. Otherwise, yeah. You sink, right?
Absolutely. And
yeah.
And we had, it was a crash course, like we started this record in Nashville, Tennessee in December of 2019 with Rich Robinson of the Black Crowes producing. Mm-hmm. And the plan was, we'll come back to Canada. We're going to do a quick theater tour with Gord Sinclair of The Hip, who had just put out a record that my brother produced. He was going to open. We did that. And then we were going to hop in the van and drive to Nashville and do another six songs. And by the end of the tour with Gord, COVID had taken over and everybody had to go home, and then the rest is history. At that point we had to figure it out, like everybody else, like what the hell are we going to do now? So, eventually we got on Zoom and did writing sessions on Zoom, did live streams from our couches. And by August, there was a loosening, 2020, there was a loosening of some restrictions. So we got together with Derek Hoffman, who produced Civilian Airs. We did three songs with him at the Jucasa Studios, just outside of Hamilton in Caledonia. And then by November, we were working with the great rock producer, Eric Ratz, when there was another loosening of restrictions. And we did some more recording at Noble Street in Toronto and at Iguana Studios in Toronto, and then we got the record, but it was piecemeal. I mean, it's the first time in our career where we had three different producers, and first pandemic, so
first pandemic.
Yeah, hopefully our last. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Hopefully. Yeah. Did you feel any kind of pressure apart from what you would normally have recording under these circumstances, just for fear that maybe everything would have to be shut down again and you couldn't complete what you just started?
Always. I mean, I still have that fear.
We got
so used to things getting canceled. It wasn't good. It wasn't good for your psyche. Like, you don't want to be the guy who, we all suffer from a negativity bias at the best of times, let alone when it's actually real. And it's been a day at a time for 2 years. I have a buddy who's in recovery, a very dear friend of mine. And I talked to him at the beginning of the pandemic and I said, "How you doing, man?" He goes, "You kidding me? Us alcoholics are fine. We've been living a day at a time for 20 years, And I was like, okay, that's wise, and you have to, you got to minimize, you got to take it back. Like, you can't get too far down the road because we don't know what's going to be around the next corner in terms of how this is all going to shake out. So we just do what we can in the moment and keep going that way. But that's hard, and it takes a lot of adjusting because it's hard to make plans these days, man.
Mm-hmm. Now, apart from that, you know, the you you have a lifestyle as a touring musician with the band and everything, but other parts of your lifestyle had to be adjusted as well. How did you adapt to that with the family and everything?
Well, I'm solo. My brother had the kids, so it was different for him. But I, you know, I just stayed in touch with friends and stuff. I mean, it wasn't the easiest time for people that were on their own, but it also wasn't very easy for people that were stuck inside with their families 24 hours a day either, homeschooling and stuff. So it was just a giant learning curve for the entire world. And I think the only comfort is a cold comfort was that everybody was experiencing it all at the same time. And in a time when, you know, media and everything's been becoming so vast and disparate. All of us experiencing something all at once has been a very rare thing. You know, we don't even do that. We don't do that in pop culture. We don't do that in literature. We don't do that in anything. We don't do that in politics. But now with the pandemic, for the first year, at least we were all experiencing exactly the same thing all together, which was a very unique thing. So there was always people you could talk to and there was always a point of reference. You know what I mean? It's not like, hey man, did you see Succession? And someone's like, I don't know what that show is. It's like, hey, how are you coping with the pandemic? And everybody's like, oh my God, it's been really hard. Oh, me too. So there was that way of staying in, and it's, I call it a cold comfort. At least we could talk about that and stay connected in our mutual struggles with this sick new world.
Yeah. Well, you know, onward to the good stuff because No, that's quite all right because you know, it's something we have to suss out with everybody and I'm really interested in everybody's take on it, especially people like you who are affected as much or more than anybody. But starting Sunday, it's like the first of 17 live dates and you get to do it in style at the Grey Cup at Tim Hortons Field. So Arkells and the Lumineers are doing the halftime. Are you're opening up the broadcast or
we're doing the tailgate party. So as people come in to see the football game, we're going to be the show. And and it's so crazy that, I mean, we're all live in Hamilton now. You know, Hamilton's prodigal sons, the Arkells are going to do the halftime show. The Tiger Cats are in the Grey Cup final. And anybody that follows football, it's a very rare occurrence when a hometown team gets into the Grey Cup or the Super Bowl. It happened with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers last year in Tampa, and it's happening with the Hamilton Tiger Cats in Hamilton. But it's a very rare thing because those cities are decided long before the season, right? So it's kind of I'll knock on wood. I don't want to jinx it, but it feels a little bit magical. I think Hamilton's going to kind of lose its mind for a day. I hope they win. And I'm excited. I mean, what's not to be excited about something that's important like that, the Grey Cup, where there's music and football and everybody getting together, you know? So I'm so happy about that. And then right after that, we're going to be in Oshawa on the 16th at the Builtmore. And I can't wait to do that too. You know, like Oshawa's kind of got a interesting place in our history because like you said, like when we first came to Ontario, before Niagara Falls, there's a little time where we came up and tried to test the waters. And Jack's uncle, who still lives in Oshawa, he was renovating a house and we stayed in a renovated house in the fall and it had heat, but it had no running water. And he had a shower that was outside because he had a pool that wasn't in use. So we would shower outside October, November, and we would gig around Toronto, anywhere they would book us. We were still called One-Eyed Trouser. And we'd hang out in Oshawa. We were living off of like, I think a Subway sandwich and a Tim Hortons coffee a day for the band members. And we'd just roam around Oshawa and then go try to find gigs at night. And so that was in the year, that was October and November of 2000. So it's cool to be able to get back to those places and just kind of think about how crazy our lives have been and also get to play a great rock show at a really cool venue. You know?
Yeah. You know, I got to be careful about how I phrase this question because every time I see a band playing live outside in very cold weather, does it feel as uncomfortable as it looks sometimes? I mean, you can see the breath, the heavy jackets.
I mean, especially here. I mean, it might not. I mean, I hope it's not going to be too bad at the Grey Cup, but there's been some nights where there's been gigs like in Fort McMurray in December and it's minus 32 out. And the only thing worse than dying of hypothermia while you rock is the space heaters that people put in front of you. And anybody that wants to know the science of instruments, A guitar can stay in tune if it's always cold, and a guitar can stay in tune if it's always hot. But if you start going between cold and hot, it will send your instruments drastically out of tune. So what, not only are you dealing with like inhumane concert conditions, and you got to, we got to wonder, why would anybody in Fort McMurray book a band outside at a certain thing for some curling event? I don't know. We'll take the gig, but I mean, it's not going to be easy. And then you're going in front of a heater because you're like, oh my God, my hands are going to freeze off my body. And you go in front of the heater and your guitar goes, and then the whole band's out of tune. So you're like, not only are the conditions horrible, the music sounds terrible. And it's just, so I'm not putting that energy out into the universe, man. Like, I don't want that to happen in Hamilton. I think it's going to be a great show. But yeah, outside in Canada, there was one New Year's Eve show in Brampton during an ice storm. And it was like, yeah, it's just too cold, you know, and those heaters actually make things worse because you're freezing and then it heats up your guitar and your guitar goes out of tune. So they're not ideal. It's not the end of the world, but it's not very easy. Yeah.
And it's difficult for the musicians, but the techs, the guitar techs and everybody, my, they have to be on their toes.
I mean, we're Canadian rock musicians. We're in the Canadian music business, man. It's a different game up here, you know, and we deal with it. But yeah, I mean, preferably New Year's Eve gigs inside for sure, you know? So there you go. Yeah, and I hope the weather.
Well, you know the old saying.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say the old saying, the show must go on.
The show must go on at all costs. Yeah.
So the December 16th, the Thursday night at the Builtmore in Oshawa.
That'll
be like your first, well, not your first full show, but it would be kind of like the first show of the tour, a week after.
Yeah, it's like
a few days after.
It's like the first official, I'm just going to double check my calendar here before I say, I know it's for sure December 16th. I just want to make sure there's nothing before it. No, yeah. So the Builtmore is the first official club show for our new record. And we're super excited. It's going to be, you know, I can't believe we get to do it, to be honest. I mean, like I feel super grateful. And so the Builtmore will be officially the kickoff show. Like the Grey Cup thing is obviously a special kind of fun thing, but it's more of our tour is going to feel more like what we're going to do in Oshawa. So that'll be good to get that going, you know.
Excitement jitters or nervous jitters for the first night?
A little bit of both. You know, full disclosure, we have been playing all along. You know, we played a lot over the summer. We took gigs where we could get them. They were like the reduced capacity things. We just did the Rock Boat that left out of Miami, Florida. And it was like that. It's like that boat with all these bands playing. And we all had to be, you know, I PCR tested up the yin yang and just like we were, you know, we played a few shows in the boat. And, you know, we shipped the cobwebs out. We've been rehearsing. So, you know, we're ready. And then you got to remember that once you're out there on game day, there's all kinds of variables, like just like a sports team. Like you can practice forever, but once you're in the moment, and it's a different thing. So we'll see how it goes. Like right now, I feel cautiously optimistic.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I don't blame you because, you know, we're still in a pandemic and Omicron's going to take over.
Yeah.
But 80% of the country is vaccinated.
Yeah.
And things do seem normal right now.
Yeah.
Despite all the restrictions, I think it's just something that we're going to have to manage in the near to medium term. Mm-hmm. And we have to make adjustments. And hopefully we figured out how to do that so we can come and see you and talk to you about all the good things rather than have you all stressed out about how you're going to pay the bills.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like everybody else, you know, we're rolling and we're doing what we can and we're staying in it and staying present and trying our best. And hopefully, you know, I think this Omicron, however they pronounce it, so far the early science is that it's a weak strain and it could be a sign of the endemic as opposed to a pandemic where it becomes the version of the flu that's not going to be like deadly. So I hope that's what's happening. I mean, at this point it's hope. And some of the early reports that I've been reading online from credible sources is that it's a weaker strain. So we'll see. And you know, we got this far together. Let's just keep going. You know, it's like I feel like the last little while has been like the last hour of a 24-hour road trip. Like you got through the first 23 because you knew how long it was going to be. But now that home is just there, it feels like forever. So we're just going to have to stay the course, as they say, and keep making music.
Well, you know, I when it all started almost 2 years ago, I suggested to some friends that when we do come out of this, we're all going to be better for it. So I hope that that sentiment prevails. And on that note, I'm going to see you next Thursday. We're
going to
pack the Builtmore, and we're going to rock out with the Trews again. And have a great time on Sunday. And
awesome.
Oski wee wee.
All right. Thank you for your time, and you have a great day.
Colin MacDonald from the Trews in the Rock Zoom Room. Cheers, my friend.
Take care, man. Bye.